of our final guests today is truly inspirational to all you budding singers out there. He left school at 16 and started working in a factory, but always harboured a desire to be a singer. So blessed with great natural ability, he slogged it out on the cabaret circuit until the chairman of Manchester United invited him to sing at Old Trafford in front of, wait for it, 55,000 fans. And I hear down the grapevine that you're going to be number one in the charts on Sunday in the classical charts.
As it stands at the moment, the midweek charts, we went straight into the classics at number one.
That's fantastic. And you're also in the pop charts as well.
Yes, number 11.
Number 11. That is amazing. First record.
We're delighted.
You must be, like, pinching yourself at the minute.
Yeah, you wake up every morning and, you know, because you work so hard to, you know, achieve and get where you're going, when it eventually happens, you know, you do have to wake up and go, is it really happening? And it is.
Now, I was talking about that Old Trafford situation. So, what, this man just came up and suddenly went, excuse me, will you do this job?
Yeah, that was the chairman of Manchester United, Martin Edwards, and, you know, when you don't instantaneously recognise somebody, but you turn around and go, oh, it's... And there was the chairman of Manchester United. And basically, he said that he'd loved what I'd done that evening. I was doing something for the Red Cross, for the Midland. And he basically came over and said that he loved what I'd done that evening and would I like to go and sing at Old Trafford in front of the faithful.
And you went, oh, I'll think about it.
I'll go and check my diary.
So was that an amazing feeling, just standing there?
It was, because, you know, as a football fan, and particularly a Manchester United fan, first of all, it was, you know, the nearest I was ever going to get to appearing at Old Trafford, because I wasn't very good at football, although I did like it.
And then Euro, with how many thousand people watching?
92,000.
And where was this? Remind me.
The Nou Camp Stadium at Barcelona. That was fantastic. Gosh. Because I'd done the last game of the season at Old Trafford, and then I got the telephone call from Manchester United the same weekend saying, do you want to come and sing at Barcelona for us? And the strange thing was that they said that the game I'd done, the last game, which was in front of 55,000, was a rehearsal.
So that was just amazing, I should think.
It was. It was. Yeah. And it was an incredible game to boot.
Well, exactly. You had the football as a bonus then that night too. Now, I know that way, way back you were doing, you know, a bit of pop, a bit of everything, really. When did you make that conscious effort to go to opera?
I think, I suppose it was about 5 or 6 years ago. And I remember something like Wigan Road Working Men's Club. And I'd just gone on after the bingo and done my spot. And a chap came up to me at the end of the night and said, I think you'd sing that Nasty Doormat well, lad. It'd suit you down to the ground. By that, what's his name? Pavarotti. So off I toddled and I learnt Nessun Dorma. I remember the first time I performed, it was the first time I ever received a standing ovation. So I might have something here.
So was it really just at that point the realisation set in that you could actually sing in this range of voice and that you could actually cope with opera?
I don't think the realisation came immediately. I think it was the reactions, you know, that I was gaining from the audiences at the time that made me think, you know, I could have something here that's a little bit different from the norm.
And, of course, you're still young, so you've got a lot of developing to go in that sense.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Voice-wise, which is great.
Still working very hard on the voice.
So are you having a voice coach then at the moment?
I have my own personal voice coach, a chap called William Hayward, who travels around the country and makes sure that I'm being a good boy.
What, like clean living?
Yes, not too much drinking, no smoking, late nights, etc.
I know, because smoke is actually the worst thing for a voice. Even for a speaking voice, smoke is very
bad,
isn't
it? Yeah, definitely. We've cut out the late nights anyway.
Well, now, when it comes to this new album, which is top of the chart, I mean, again, first time out in terms of recording,
yeah,
to go straight in, what mix have you put on the album?
Well, we've got a mix of operatic arias and Neapolitan love songs, and there's a few modern ballads on there as well. For instance, Vienna and Bridge Over Troubled Water.
Well, I think that's great, because I saw you in the park last year. You appeared with Sir Cliff in Hyde Park.
I did.
I mean, that was an amazing occasion too, wasn't
it? It wasn't. It's great to work with somebody like Sir Cliff, because you just learn so much from such a professional, and he's so, you know, he's so focused on what he's doing, and you watch the organisation and the team around him, it's incredible, and you just learn and feed from people like that.
And all his fans, if I remember, really took to you that night. So you did that duet, because he recorded that piece of opera, didn't he, for his last album?
Vita Mia. It was bizarre, because my mum was a big Cliff Richard fan, you know, when I was a kid. And so to be on stage with him, you know, all those years later was incredible.
You had arrived.
Yes, it was strange. It was very strange.
So what are your plans now? I mean, clearly, to be number one on the classical charts opens up a whole new world. I mean, are you going to be travelling worldwide much more?
We've got a lot of travelling planned, you know, with promotions, and Decca Universal and my record company have got plans for us to, you know, shoot over to Europe and start promoting the album over there. So obviously that's very exciting.
And I would think, as, again, for a singer, you know, one minute you're in a workman's club and the next minute you're performing with the big orchestras of the world. Yeah. And that's such a luxury, isn't it?
It is. And as I said before, you know, it's the same old... You wake up in the morning and think, you know, is this really happening to me? One minute I'm there with Fred on the organs and Bill on the drums, and the next minute I've got the finest orchestra in the world backing me.